10 to win and the last man in. My pick of Test Match Cliffhangers. Written and read by Henry Blofeld. To see all the match statistics, please refer to the accompanying PDF. At one match in 10,000, the ritual cricket equation of runs, wickets and time resolves itself into the pattern of complete drama. When that happens, it is not necessary to know cricket to correlate all this data, to feel that its ingredients, like the elements of the Greek drama, have compelled a balanced perfection of construction. It is in the air. John Arlott. Preface. The idea of this book came to me one day when I was poring over Henry Newbolt's Vitae Lampada, which my father first read to me when I was only in single figures and in the early stages of discovering my passion for cricket. For me, it now begs the question, is there nothing in sport to compete with the sustained excitement of a cricket match, especially a test match, in which the advantage continually fluctuates one way and then the other, and when the match enters its last few minutes, all four results are still possible? I have been lucky to watch one or two of these myself, from the commentary box and the press box, and even sitting in the stand as an ordinary spectator. Before I go on, I must say both strongly and apologetically that this is a personal collection, and of course everyone who listens to this book will have their own idea of the matches I should have come up with. This is the joy of mulling over cricket matches like this. I have chosen 24 test matches, all of which have seen extraordinary finishes, and four one-day internationals where the drama at the end can be similarly breathtaking, even without the same tantalising four innings and five-day build-up. This comparison brings with it the thought that two innings test cricket is an examination, while the one-day game, for all its instant advantages of glamour and action, is an exhibition. I have not included any 2020 games, and at the time of writing, the new 100 competition in England has not yet left the drawing board. Both of these newer forms of the game can and will be hugely exciting, but without answering the pertinent question, are they really cricket? Maybe, but as different as instant coffee is from that made from freshly ground beans. Or maybe, as David Hockney and Jeff Koons are, from Constable and Turner. Not all of these test matches have built up in the beguiling way I have suggested, and several have pottered along for 3 or 4 days before exploding at the end like an outrageous firework display. Of course, once you know the final outcome, the build-up may well assume a new and more vibrant perspective. In 1960-61, if Australia had decided to bat out the fifth day of what became the first ever tied test match at Brisbane for a draw, the other ingredients, most notably Gary Sobers' 132 or Alan Davidson's remarkable all-round performance, would never have been appreciated as they deserved. The beauty of the construction work may only be fully understood when the building has been finished and the component parts can then be seen in relation to the beauty of the whole. In spite of all I have said in these last three paragraphs, it is hard to deny that the World Cup final at Lord's in 2019 saw the most incredible finish there has ever been to a game of cricket. Ben Stokes and Joss Butler retrieved England's fortunes in the main match, which was tied, and then took them to a position which led to that extraordinary match-winning tie in the second, the Super Over. Within the month, Stokes had done it again. In the Test match at Headingley, this time with left-arm bespectacled spinner Jack Leach, a Harry Potter-like figure, as his unlikely partner when they put on 74 for the last wicket to beat Australia. The finishes to limited over matches are relentlessly and repetitiously exciting, but I can say with confidence that the climax to this World Cup final at Lord's, when these four, infamous overthrows made the difference at the very end will surely never be repeated, while the last 2 hours at Headingley will not come along too often. I cannot leave that Lord's final without paying tribute not only to the cricketing skills and know-how of the New Zealand captain, Kane Williamson, but also to his and his team's supreme sportsmanship when they were deserted by Lady Luck in the cruelest of ways right at the end. England's women had set the standard 2 years earlier, when, as you will see, Anya Shrubsole bowled the side to a remarkable last-minute victory. In all the cricket I have watched, I have not sat through another match as exciting from first ball to last as the fifth test in Georgetown, Guyana in 1967-68, or such a nerve-wracking sixth and final day as we had in the same match. I was on the air in 1981 when Bob Willis removed Ray Bright's middle stump to give England an extraordinary victory in what became known, a trifle unfairly to Willis, 8 for 43 in Australia's second innings, as Botham's match after his almost eponymous 149 not out. I was also commentating when Ian Botham removed Geoff Thompson by way of a catch, first dropped at second slip and then held by first slip at Melbourne in 1982-83, which brought England victory by 3 runs. There is plenty to choose from. I shall go to my grave hoping that if all then works out well for me, I shall somehow be in a position to watch Spofforth. His bunny was no less a batsman than WG, taking 14 wickets at the Oval in 1882. This, I hope, will be followed by the last two Test matches in 1902 at Old Trafford and the Oval. Stanley Jackson's 128 in the first of those two must have been an amazing innings, as must Gilbert Jessop's remarkable 75-minute 100 in the second, before arguably the most famous last-wicket pair of all time, George Hurst and Wilfred Rhodes, did not resolve to get the 15 still needed in singles, but got them all the same. Another innings I would have loved to have seen was Kenneth Hutchings' 126 at Melbourne in 1907-8. Then there was Jack Crawford, who has become a hero of mine while I was writing the book. We see him as a young all-rounder, only 4 months out of school at Repton, in South Africa in 1905-06, and then 2 years later in Australia. He must have been a tricky chap, but he was a genius when it came to batting and to bowling his quick off-breaks. And then there was the redoubtable Aubrey Faulkner, the South African who, for me, was relatively unknown when I began to write, but by the end had become my joint favourite cricketer of all time, along with Dennis Compton, who we see adroitly steering England to a stirring victory in a low-scoring match on a wet pitch in Durban. Enjoy Aubrey Faulkner and lament at his sad end. I had as wonderful a time delving into these almost prehistoric Test matches as I did reliving those that I've actually watched. I also had a lot of fun with the 450-over matches, which I could not possibly have left out. Having said that, the near misses and leftovers would have made another pretty exciting book too. There are two games I need to explain, although as soon as you hear their story, I'm sure you will agree that they more than deserve their inclusion. There is a great and happy romance in the story of Archie MacLaren's victory over the Australians at Eastbourne in 1921, and the deeds of Robert Fowler for Eton at Lord's in 1910 can only produce an amused bewilderment, even among Harrovians. The progress of Lieutenant Colonel C.P. Foley, who left the barber's chair in White's Club with his hair half cut and Harrow 21 for 6, before racing with Lord Brackley in a taxi to Lord's, was exciting. His lordship even promised to pay the driver double fare if he did it in under 15 minutes, and their adventure plays its part in showing what an absurdly irresistible game cricket can be. Match 1. The Demon. England v Australia. Only Test. 28th, 29th of August, 1882, The Oval, London. Australia won by 7 runs. The second Test match ever played in England was one of the most thrilling games of all time. It ended in 2 days as the result of some of the most devastating bowling in the history of the game. The Australian fast bowler, Frederick Spofforth, known appropriately as the Demon, took 7 wickets in each England innings. He finished with 14 for 90 in a match which produced only 363 runs in 4 completed innings. The highest score was a hard-hit 55 by Australian opening batsman Hugh Massey. The Ashes came into being as a direct result of this match, which was the first England had lost at home. Before we get into the match itself, the story of the Ashes must once more be told. A day or two after England's defeat at the Oval, the Sporting Times published a mock obituary notice proclaiming the death of English cricket and ending by saying that the body would be cremated and the ashes taken to Australia. The following winter, the Honourable Ivo Bligh took a side out to play a series of 3 official matches against Australia. The first 2 were played in Melbourne, Australia winning the first and England the second. On the Sunday after the second match, the England players were invited to lunch by the Clark family in Sunbury. 2 spirited ladies who were the daughters of the house burned a couple of bales, and who knows what else, put the resulting ashes into an urn and presented it to Bligh, although at that point the series stood at 1-1, and it was, therefore, a romantic gesture. England then won the 3rd official test in Sydney, and a 4th match was then decided upon, also in Sydney, which Australia won to level the series. For this match, they experimented by using a new pitch for each innings. In 1927, on the death of Bligh, who had by then become Lord Darnley, his family presented the urn as a gift to the MCC. It was not until England visited Australia in 1902-03 that it became generally accepted that the Ashes was what the 2 countries played for, even though they have remained permanently in England, first as the property of Lord Darnley and then of the Marylebone Cricket Club. In 1880, England had beaten Australia by 5 wickets at the Oval, principally, it seemed, because Spofforth had been unable to play because of an injured finger. 2 years later, the Englishmen discovered how lucky they had been, for Spofforth was an extraordinary bowler. He had started his cricketing life as an underarm lob bowler. He had then watched the England players who visited Australia in 1863-64 and had been impressed by the fast bowling of George Tarrant and decided that this was where his future lay. He was ideally built for the job, being a big man who stood 6'3" tall. He was also slim, strong, and extremely fit. While Spofforth relied on sheer pace at the start of his fast bowling career, it was not long before he revealed that his real genius lay in his ability to adapt his style and perfect subtle variations. One of his main strengths was his ability to change his pace without in any way altering his frenetic action. It was reckoned he could bowl at 3 different speeds without signalling his intentions. He also bowled what were known in those days as breakbacks, which later were called off breaks. He could turn the ball the full width of the stumps, given any help from the pitch. His accuracy was remarkable, and he had an almost unplayable fast yorker. No other bowler has ever clean bowled such a large proportion of his victims. From his short run-up, less than 10 yards, he went into his delivery stride with a huge leap. The action itself was all whirling arms and legs, and he had a long straight follow-through which damaged the pitch on a good length at the bowler's end, although in those days no one worried too much about that. Spofforth was a fearsome spectacle. He is described by a contemporary as having a swarthy complexion, black moustache and steely brown eyes, which conveyed an unmistakable aura of hostility. Another said he had a Mephistophelian cast of countenance and a Catherine wheel action, which was all legs, arms, and nose. Spofforth had an impressive aquiline nose. In his introduction to Richard Daft's Kings of Cricket, Andrew Lang wrote of Spofforth's action, "It has withal something truculent and overbearing." In the late 1870s, Spofforth was reckoned to bowl as fast as anyone had ever done. It is surprising, therefore, to find that the first wicket he took for Australia against England at Melbourne in 1876-77, the batsman, Alfred Shaw, was stumped, as were another 18 of his first-class victims. His principal victim, rather surprisingly, was W.G. Grace, whom he sent back 19 times in first-class matches. In that first match at the Oval, when Spofforth was not playing, Grace had made 152. One of Spofforth's habits was to stare belligerently at batsmen as they walked out to bat and took guard. W.G. would not have enjoyed that. At this distance in time, it seems strange that Billy Murdoch's side of 1882 should have come all the way from Australia for one solitary representative game against All England in late August. They had begun their first game against Oxford University on the 15th of May and played 25 first-class matches before this all-important contest at the Oval. England, who had never been beaten at home, confidently expected to win a match scheduled to be played over 3 days. They were captained by Albert Monkey Hornby, who also played rugby for his country. The Oval was full for the 2 days needed, with more than 20,000 people packed into the ground. Although with so few runs being scored, the pitch can hardly have been a batsman's paradise. Murdoch won an important toss for Australia on a damp morning, for there had been much recent rain, and decided to bat. Amid great excitement, the start, which was delayed because of the weather, was made at 12:10. The Australian innings was then opened by Massey and Alec Bannerman, whose brother Charles had played an innings of 165 out of 245 in what eventually was considered to have been the first ever test match, played in Melbourne in March 1877. Those two had put on only 6 when a yorker from George Eliot hit Massey's leg stump. The score had reached 21 when Murdoch played Edmund Peat's left-arm spin into his wicket, and one run later, Richard Barlow removed George Bonner's middle stump. W.G. then held on to a pretty good one with his left hand low down at point when Bannerman cut at Peat, and Australia had lurched to 26-4. It was hard, and there was a succession of maiden overs. Bannerman had batted more than an hour for 9, which says much for England's bowlers, but maybe not too much for the state of the rain-affected pitch. The crowd were loving every moment, for although it was generally expected that England would win the match, this was a brilliant start, and on it went. 4 runs later, Tom Horan lost his leg stump to Barlow, and before another run had been added, George Giffen was bowled by Peat, who then had Tom Garrett well caught, much to the delight of the crowd, by Surrey's Morris Reed at long off. Soon after lunch, there was a short break for rain, and then Peat and Barlow quickly finished off the innings. Australia had only themselves to blame for being bowled out for as little as 63 after the demon Spofforth had struck a solitary but perhaps meaningful 4. After this extraordinary start, an air of confidence settled round the ground as the crowd sat back to watch England, who were batting by 3:30 on this first day, take full control of the match. This confidence soon proved to be misplaced. England had scored only 13 when Spofforth, much to his delight, got his bunny, yorking W.G. with a beauty. 5 runs later, Barlow was picked up by Bannerman at what in those days was called forward point, a sort of close cover point in front of square, and England were 18-2. The spectators were being made to realise that this was going to be a closely fought contest. Every ball now seemed threatening, and as a result, every run was enthusiastically cheered. For all the formal Victorian clothes and outfits, everyone in the crowd was now completely involved with what was going on in the middle. The atmosphere was electric. Alfred Lucas and George Eliot played some exhilarating strokes, taking the score to 50 after only half an hour's play. Soon afterwards, Eliot, known as Happy Jack, jumped out to drive Spofforth, yes, Spofforth, and was easily stumped. The amazing thing about this was that Spofforth must surely have started off by bowling fast, with Jack Blackham standing back. Now, after only half an hour's play, Spofforth had his wicketkeeper standing up close to the stumps. It is one thing to vary your pace, but quite another to alter your style of bowling, which Jack Blackham's position now suggests. Spofforth and Blackham were an important combination, just as Dennis Lilly and Rod Marsh were to become almost 100 years later. Blackham had a hand in a great many of Spofforth's dismissals. Two runs later at 59, Lucas got a thin edge to Harry Boyle, and Blackham was in business again. When Spofforth hit Charles Studd's bails one run later, England had lost half their wickets for 60 and was still 3 runs behind. With the scores level, Alfred Littleton pushed uncertainly outside the off stump, giving Blackham his 3rd dismissal and Spofforth his 5th wicket. It was only an 8th wicket stand of 26 between Maurice Reed and Alan Steele that enabled England to reach 3 figures and a lead of 38 runs. Spofforth finished off the innings, getting rid of Hornby and Pete, and taking in all 7 for 46 in 36 overs. England were all out for 101, 5 minutes before the close of play on the first day. It had been an amazing day's entertainment for the big crowd, and what a match they now had on their hands. Another factor which makes this seem even more extraordinary for listeners today is the fact that no fewer than 151.3 overs were bowled during a day on which 20 wickets fell. It rained heavily during the night, and again Australia did not begin their second innings until 10 past midday, although in a book he later wrote, Dick Barlow said the pitch was not fit for play. The bowlers' footholds were completely waterlogged. Massey and Bannerman took full advantage of the conditions as Massey went for his strokes, while Bannerman made sure he stayed in at the other end, and for the first time in the match, the bat was in charge. After only 28 minutes' play, 30 runs were on the board, and Hornby had already made 2 bowling changes. By 2:45, England's lead of 38 had been knocked off. They had put on 47 when William Barnes took over from Studd. And of his first ball, Lucas made a mess of a straightforward catch at long off from a lofted off drive which had not come quite out of the middle of the bat. Immediately after this, WG was seen to be pulling thoughtfully at his beard. Massey was then 38, and the 50 came up immediately afterwards in only 40 minutes. Massey played some thrilling strokes, much to the crowd's enjoyment. 16 runs later, there was great jubilation when Massey hit across a straight half volley from Steele and was bowled. He had made 55 out of 66 in 57 minutes, hitting 9 fours in the most commanding and entertaining innings of the match. The crowd were generous in their appreciation. Massey's place was taken by Bonner, and 4 rounds later his middle stump was clinically removed by Eliot. Bannerman's patient innings came to an end before another run had been scored. He drove Barnes to extra cover, having batted 70 minutes for his 13 runs. W.G. Gray soon picked up Horan with a good catch close in on the offside. And when Giffin was immediately out in exactly the same way, Australia was 79 for 5, only 41 runs ahead. With the clouds gathering, Blackham now joined Murdoch. Without too much difficulty, they had taken the score to 99 when it began to rain, and so lunch was taken. A second shower delayed the start until 2:45, and before another run had been scored, Blackham was beautifully caught behind the wicket by his opposite number, Alfred Littleton. Sam Jones, who'd gone in at number 10 in the first innings, now came in eighth. He and Murdoch had taken the score to 114 when a most unfortunate incident involving W.G. Grace caused Jones to be run out. Murdoch had played a ball gently away to leg, and Littleton, the wicketkeeper, set off in pursuit. He returned the ball to the stumps, and Jones, having completed the easy single, imagined the ball was now dead and moved out of his crease to tap down a spot on the pitch. Grace, who was always a fierce competitor, happy to push the laws to the limit and perhaps even to indulge in a spot of sharp practice, was holding the ball. Seeing that Jones was out of his crease, he immediately broke the wicket and appealed. Bob Toms, an experienced umpire, was standing at square leg and had no option but to give Jones out. It may have been the letter of the law, as W.G. will have known only too well, but it was certainly not the spirit. Understandably, the Australians, and most particularly Murdoch, who was playing a wonderfully patient and important captain's innings, were extremely upset. When the immediate high feelings had cooled down a little, one member of the Australian side, no doubt a diplomat at heart, which is not always a major attribute of his fellow countrymen, admitted that he would have done the same if he had been in Grace's place. One inhabitant of the pavilion was reported to have said, surely with his tongue in his cheek, Jones ought to thank the champion for teaching him something. Spofforth, who now joined Billy Murdoch, was also visibly upset. I wonder if anyone else on the England side that day would have behaved as Grace had done. Grace's reputation is such that I rather doubt it. Heavily bearded, of course, and supremely confident, he believed he could do almost anything and get away with it. He was an incomparable cricketer, but perhaps not an incomparable sportsman. These incidents leave a nasty taste. Spofforth's middle stump soon became a lost cause, and Murdoch's splendid defence was ended when he was run out by some smart fielding from Hornby, helped by Charles Studd and then Littleton. Boyle, the last man, soon perished to steal, and Australia were all out at 25 minutes past three for 122. Edmund Pete, a Yorkshireman who had opened the bowling for England with his orthodox left-arm spin, had taken 4 for 40 in Australia's second innings to add to his 4 for 31 in the first. He had bowled beautifully, and Lord Hawke, his county captain, said that he was blessed with the most perfect action one could ever wish to see. England had been left to score 85 to win, and they must have felt reasonably confident of getting them, even though it was far from being the best of pitches. No one could have foreseen the drama and the excitement that was to come. There was probably only one man on the ground who was certain England would not win, and he was in the Australian dressing room. As the players were preparing to go out onto the field, Spofforth spoke loud and clear when he said, "Boys, this thing can be done." England began the final innings of the match at 3:45 when W.G. went out with his captain Hornby, who curiously had batted at number 10 in the first innings. They put on 15 in the first 15 minutes before Hornby, who had made 9 of them, had his off stump knocked over by Spofforth, whose hostility and determination was easy to see. Barlow took Hornby's place, and his first ball beat him for pace and bowled him. Some excitingly adventurous stroke play from both Grace and Ulliott took the score to 51 when Spofforth changed ends. Ulliott played for a breakback, and when the ball went straight on, it took the edge and he was brilliantly caught by Blackham behind the stumps. England now needed 34 with 7 wickets in hand. Surely they could not lose. This brought in Lucas, and after tucking a ball neatly away for 2, Grace drove at Boyle without getting to the pitch of the ball, and Bannerman held a simple catch at mid-off. Littleton now joined Lucas and adopted a purely defensive role, while his bustling partner made more of an attempt to keep the score moving. Even so, the game came almost to a standstill, and 12 successive maiden overs, 4 balls each, were bowled by Spofforth and Boyle. Spofforth now hatched a plot with Boyle and arranged a piece of deliberate misfielding by Bannerman at mid-off, which allowed the batsman to take a single and change ends. This meant both the bowlers had a different batsman to work on. The tactic worked. After four more maiden overs, Spofforth took his fourth wicket when he bowled Littleton, and England was 66 for five, needing only 19 more to win, with five wickets left. The cricket was as tense and exciting as anyone in the ground could remember. The crowd cheered every run to the echo, but the force was with the Australian bowlers, led by the incomparable Spofforth. Lucas hit a four, but Steele fell to Spofforth's slower ball, which was almost impossible to spot. He would let his slower ball go with seemingly the same speed of arm action he used to bowl his fastest deliveries. Steele played too soon and spooned up an easy return catch to the bowler, who in anticipation had run far across to the leg side to take the catch. The whole ground now vibrated with excitement, but before another run had been scored, Spofforth, bowling maybe with much the same determination as Bob Willis had shown all those years later at Headingley, blasted one through Lucas's defence and spread-eagled his stumps. This brought in Barnes, who scored a somewhat fortunate two. Then came three byes, which were greeted with thunderous cheers as they took the score to 75. 10 were now needed. The tension had been such that already one poor, unfortunate spectator had died from a heart attack. Another was busily chewing his way through what must have been a highly indigestible umbrella handle. Lucas had been in a long time for his five and was doing the important job for England of making one end safe. Suddenly, and for no obvious reason, he played Spofforth, against whom he had been defending with some ease, into his stumps. Moments later, with Studd as his new partner, Barnes gave a simple catch to Murdoch off his glove, which made it 75 for nine. Pete, who was the last man, turned Boyle to square leg for two, before being comprehensively bowled by the next ball. Australia had won an astonishing game of cricket by seven runs in less than 2 days. It was hugely appropriate that such a dramatically exciting game as this should have led directly to the formation of the Ashes. The urn could not have been given a more inspirational baptism. Maybe it was also appropriate, in view of the result of this match, that the urn which carries the ashes should have then come from Australia. Match 2. Fred Tate's last stand. England v Australia, fourth test, 24th to the 26th of July, 1902, Old Trafford, Manchester. Australia won by 3 runs. The golden age of cricket, which stretched from 1890 to 1914, had nothing finer to offer than the last two test matches on Australia's tour of England in 1902. They remain as two of the most exciting games ever to have been played in an Ashes series. Australia won the first at Old Trafford by 3 runs, making sure they retained the Ashes, and England won the second at the Oval by 1 wicket. The cast list was incomparable. Archie MacLaren, F.S. Jackson, Gilbert Jessop, K.S. Ranjisinghe, C.B. Fry, George Hurst and Wilfred Rhodes were among those who did battle for England, while Australia's ranks included Victor Trumper, Clem Hill, Hugh Trumbull, Joe Darling and Monty Noble. No two players defined the Golden Age more than Trumper and Ranji. The teams arrived in Manchester after rain had prevented England winning at Edgbaston in the first test of the series and almost completely washed out the next game at Lord's. Australia had then convincingly won the only test match ever played at Bramall Lane in Sheffield, and so were one up in the series when the teams met at Old Trafford. It is amusing to realise that the selection of the England side for this fourth test caused huge criticism, and at this distance in time, the final selections still seem inexplicable. The main reason for this may have been that the England captain, McLaren, had fallen out with Lord Hawke, who was the formidable chairman of the selectors. George Hurst, Sidney Barnes, Jessop and Fry had been dropped after England had lost at Bramall Lane, and they were replaced by Lionel Palarit, Ranji, who had recovered from a leg injury, Bill Lockwood, and most surprisingly, Fred Tate, who was having a successful season for Sussex. Barnes had taken 6 for 49 in Australia's first innings in the previous match and was now replaced by Tate, who would effectively cost England the match. The decision not to play Barnes was so strange that it looks as if Lord Hawke must have been trying to show McLaren who was in control. Australia won the toss and decided to bat. The ground was wet, and to start with, the slow pitch played so easily that Trumper, who was in the form of his life, became the first batsman ever to score 100 before lunch in a test match. On this tour, Trumper strode through the country in a way no other batsman has been able to imitate. In an unusually wet summer, he made 2,570 runs with 11 centuries. These are the sort of figures associated with Don Bradman, but there the comparison ends. One difference between the two, according to his teammate Monty Noble, was that whenever Trumper reached 100, he then felt it was somebody else's turn. Bradman could never be accused of allowing such a thought to enter his mind. There was something inevitable, almost prosaic, about an innings by Bradman, whereas every stroke Trumper played was a joint product of genius and imagination. Bradman's story was told mainly by the quantity of his runs. Trumper's by the natural quality of his stroke play, coupled with his own joyful nature, which seemed untainted by conscious thought, let alone a coach's advice. It goes without saying that he saw the ball early, and his unhurried footwork always left him perfectly placed to play whichever stroke he chose. Trumper and Reggie Duff put on 135 for the first wicket in 80 minutes. At lunch, Australia were 173 for one, with Trumper and Clem Hill in control. England were handicapped by the wet ground, and the approach to the wicket was so damp that Bill Lockwood was unable to bowl at the start because of the state of the run-ups. One of the reasons the scoring was rapid on this first morning was that Wilfred Rhodes, sir left arm, and Stanley Jackson, who was medium pace, opened the bowling, and so the over rate was excellent. In those days, the bowling was often opened by spinners. Trumper perished immediately after lunch, beaten in the air perhaps, and caught behind off Rhodes. Clem Hill, who once he emerged from his ugly crouching stance, was the most delightful stroke maker, in spite of holding his bat at the very bottom of the handle. As that suggests, he was a bottom-handed player and, like most left-handers, particularly strong off his legs. As he was a short man, he did not have quite the fluency of stroke play the taller left-handers usually seem to have. He batted well for his 65 now, and there was also a most determined knock of 51 from Darling. The innings were finished off for England by Lockwood, who, bowling with rhythm and pace, took the last five wickets, finishing with 6 for 48. Lockwood was a bad-tempered man who was by no means universally liked. He had a Machiavellian streak within him. There seemed also to be a deliberate viciousness to his bowling, which may have been in part the reflection of a confused and unhappy character. He was the fifth bowler McLaren had turned to in this innings because of the state of those run-ups. When Lockwood eventually found his feet, he was too much for the Australians, who had a problem spotting his well-concealed slower ball. In spite of all this, it was the opinion of no less a person than C.B. Fry that Lockwood would top the polls for the most genuine fast bowler in the history of the game up to that time. Lockwood made one unsuccessful tour to Australia and in all took 43 wickets in his 12 test matches. Australia were all out after tea for 299. On a pitch which was drier and had been roughed up by the England bowlers, the biting left-arm spin of Jack Saunders and the accuracy of the tall Hugh Trumbull's off-spin soon proved to be devastating. By the close of play on this first night, England was struggling at 70 for 5, Saunders having taken 3 wickets and Trumbull 2. Stanley Jackson and Len Braund had by then added 26 anxious runs for the 6th wicket. The next morning, the pitch played more easily, and in a wonderful session for England, these two put on another 115 with a fine display of strokes. Jackson's driving and cutting was particularly impressive. Then, just before lunch, Braund came forward to drive a ball from Noble, wide of the off stump, with his bat away from his body, and it flew off the inside edge into the stumps. After the interval, Jackson did not get much support from the lower order, but with the last two batsmen in, he set about the bowling with some magnificent strokes. Jackson had come in when England were 30 for 4 and was last out after batting for 4.5 hours for his 128. It was a great innings and the best of all that he played for his country. Jackson was a man of many talents as well as being an extraordinary cricketer. As a schoolboy, he played for 3 years in the 11 at Harrow, where Winston Churchill had been his fag. When Jackson became a Member of Parliament, Churchill introduced him to future Prime Minister David Lloyd George, who said to him at once, "I've been looking all my life for the man who gave Winston Churchill a hiding at school." As captain of Cambridge University, Jackson had brought Randy Sinji into the side in face of considerable opposition, for he was the first Indian to play for the university. After being elected to Parliament in 1915, Jackson spent 11 years as a member before being made Governor of Bengal. He was there for 5 years, and in 1932, when making a speech at Calcutta University, he survived an assassination attempt. A girl who was a member of a revolutionary party fired 5 pistol shots at him at close range, but her aim was poor. Apparently Jackson's coolness under fire was impressive, and when the immediate kerfuffle had died down, he continued his speech. He played in 20 test matches, all of them against Australia, but never went on any tour because of his considerable business commitments. At Old Trafford, Australia had a first innings lead of 37. They began their second innings at 4 o'clock on the second afternoon, and in no time they were 10 for 3. With the new ball, Lockwood was a nasty proposition, bowling at a good pace and still managing to bring the ball back sharply off the pitch into the right-hander. His slower ball also caused problems, and in his opening overs, he sent back the formidable trio of Trumper, Duff and Hill. 6 more runs had been scored when the captain, the left-handed Darling, a real fighter, was facing Braund, a leg spinner, who had taken over from Tate. Braund wanted his Somerset colleague, Lionel Pallaritt, to come up to short leg, which was where he always fielded when Braund was bowling for his county. Pallaritt had been at deep square leg with his back to the railway line, and now McLaren sent Tate, normally a close fielder, to take his place. Braund bowled short, and Darling, with a score of 16 for 3, swung the ball high to deep square leg. Tate hovered for a long time underneath the ball and dropped a catch he never looked like holding. Darling and Gregory went on to add 54 in a stand which ultimately was responsible for Australia's victory. It was McLaren who, as captain, had made the fateful decision on the first morning of the match to play Tate, a good, honest county cricketer, instead of Hurst, a player of an altogether different calibre. He obviously did not want Lord Hawke, the chairman, and like Hurst, a Yorkshireman, to have the last word. Darling went on to make 37, but if that catch had been held, Australia would have been hard-pressed to reach 50. As it was, they were 85 for 8 at the end of the second day, and England still appeared to be winning the match. Tate's dropped catch had not yet assumed its ultimate importance. In retrospect, poor Tate at least had the satisfaction of taking 2 wickets for England when he had both Gregory and Trumbull, LBW. The last two wickets fell the next morning for the addition of just one run after heavy overnight rain had delayed the start until midday. Lockwood finished with 5 for 28, which gave him the splendid match figures of 11 for 76. England had to make 124 to win, but on what was a drying pitch, their target now looked more difficult. In the 50 minutes of play before lunch, in sunny weather, McLaren and Pallaritt got them off to a splendid start, scoring 36 without being separated. There was a full house crowd and they will have enjoyed their lunch, although acute indigestion was only just round the corner. By the time play had restarted, the sun was getting to work on the pitch. 8 more runs had been scored when Saunders turned one a long way, which curled past Pallaritt's outside edge and bowled him. Johnny Tildesley joined McLaren, and with the ball turning and lifting, the batting became more anxious, as if they realised they had to score the runs quickly before the sun made the surface even more difficult. Tildesley made 16 in quick time before he drove at Saunders and was caught by Warwick Armstrong at slip. 4 rounds later, McLaren was caught in the deep off Trumbull, and England was 72 for 3, with only 52 needed. Numerically, there was no reason for undue anxiety, but in these last few minutes, the game had undergone a sea change. There were also 2 new batsmen at the crease, even if they were as experienced as Ranji and Bobby Able. As in the first innings, Ranji looked out of both form and confidence and was hardly recognisable as the man who had made 154 against Australia at Old Trafford 6 years before. They took the score uneasily to 92 when Ranji, caught in two minds, was LBW to another medium-paced off-break from Trumbull. It had become a thrilling and tense dogfight. By now, the crowd were more than aware that an England victory was by no means a foregone conclusion. They were most certainly on the edge of their seats. Trumbull was as understated as a man as he was as a bowler. He stood 6'5" tall, with a narrow face, a large nose, and ears like bat's wings. He was the calmest of men, with the most equable temperament. Nothing would upset him, and his was the perfect temperament for a spin bowler. If his face was anything to go by, he would have made a brilliant poker player. With a lovely high action, he bowled his off-breaks at a brisk medium pace. Monty Noble described his action as sidelong and insinuating, with his neck craned like a gigantic bird. Although Trumbull thrived most of all on the softer wickets in England, he was always a threat on the harder pitches in Australia as well. His control was impeccable and was allied to subtle variations of pace and flight. He took 141 wickets for Australia in 32 test matches, and now at Old Trafford he had 4 for 75 in England's first innings and would take 6 for 53 in the second. Trumbull was the first of the great off-spinners. 5 more runs had been scored when he struck again. Abel came forward to drive and was beaten in the air and bowled. Jackson drove Saunders to Gregory at mid-off. Braun came down the pitch to Trumbull and was stumped. Trumbull then took his 5th wicket when he bowled Lockwood for a duck. These 4 had been dismissed for the addition of 17 runs, leaving England perilously placed at 109 for 8, still needing another 15. The new batsman was Rhodes, in the absence of Hurst, the ideal man to have coming in at such a point. The sight of Rhodes soothed the nerves, and without any fuss, he hit a 4, which was greeted by the crowd as if it was the match-winning stroke. His partner, Dick Lilly, now played 2 strokes, which brought him a 2 and a single. 8 were needed when Lilly faced Trumbull. A terrific heave, accompanied by yells of joy from the crowd, and the ball soared away towards square leg for what must have seemed a certain 4. Clem Hill was fielding it wide long on, and as soon as the ball began to climb into the air, he set off like a greyhound. Just when it looked as if he would not quite make it, he despairingly stuck out his right hand and held an unbelievable catch in front of the pavilion. To say the crowd was stunned would be an understatement. Neville Cardus's mythical parson in the half-crown stand summed it up to perfection. A sinful catch was how he described it. As poor Fred Tate made his way to the middle, the memory of that dropped catch will have been searing through his mind. He arrived at the non-striker's end and watched Rhodes defend the last three balls of Trumbull's over. Now, as Tate was just about to take guard to face Saunders, heavy rain began to fall. The players scampered back to the pavilion, but they knew it would not be for too long. There was clear sky in the distance where the weather was coming from. Tate's anxious respite lasted for only 40 minutes before he and Rhodes followed the Australians back onto the field at 6 minutes to 5. Now, with 8 runs needed for an England victory, Tate took guard. He poked at Saunders's first ball, which somehow found the inside edge of the bat, and raced away to the fine leg boundary, accompanied by frenzied cheering, which in the circumstances may not have done that much for Tate's peace of mind. The best way of describing Saunders's next 2 balls is to say that somehow, with defensive strokes which were themselves pretty sinful, Tate managed to survive them both. The next ball, which Saunders pushed through, was a shooter and left Tate stranded and crashed into his stumps. Australia had won by 3 runs and had made sure of the Ashes too, now being 2 matches up with 1 to play. Tate's walk back to the pavilion was the final act in one of the more extraordinary Test careers. The family's reputation at this level of the game was to be left in the safe hands of his son, Maurice, who was himself to play in 39 Test matches for England. Match 3. The Croucher. England v Australia. 5th Test. 11th to the 13th of August, 1902. The Oval, London. England won by 1 wicket. The players had hardly got their breath back after the dramas and excitement of the Old Trafford Test, when they came to the Oval 2 weeks later for another match which was, if anything, even more exciting. Needing 263 to win, they had slumped to 48 for 5 when Gilbert Jessop hit maybe the most amazing Test 100 of all. He was 7th out for 104 when the score was 187, with 76 runs still needed. It was the cool heads and straight bats of those two stalwart Yorkshiremen, George Hurst and Wilfred Rhodes, that eventually steered England home as they added the 15 needed for the last wicket. As Rhodes, the last man, came out to bat, the story has it that Hurst greeted him with, "We'll get 'em in singles." Both of them later denied this was ever said, and in any case, the runs were not all scored in singles. The game could not help but start as something of an anticlimax. Australia's victory at Old Trafford had already enabled them to retain the Ashes, which had been in their hands since 1897-98. For all that, England's honour was at stake, and at least a good showing, if not victory, was important. As at Old Trafford, and in the best traditions of a game, which in those days assumed an important place in society at most levels, this match at the Oval fluctuated intriguingly and ended up as probably the more exciting of the 2 matches. The memory of this match is still very much alive, not least because as a 15-year-old, the playwright Ben Travers was among the spectators. In 1980, he wrote a book called 94 Declared, which included a description of the match from his own perspective and as his memory would allow. His mind was still amazingly sharp, and this piece brings the game alive in an unusual and extremely gripping way, even though it is now just over 118 years ago. Travers came up with some details which were as fascinating as they were surprising, and which, after all this time, had remained sharply etched in his mind. In June 1980, during the lunch interval on the Saturday of the Test against the West Indies at Lord's, Travers had come into the Test match special commentary box at the top of the pavilion, primed with John Arlott's Mowat, and talked to Brian Johnston about this Test at the Oval. The interview was so popular that Travers was persuaded to write a book about his memories of the match. He died at the age of 94, soon after finishing it. Australia won the toss and inevitably decided to bat. Putting the other side in at the Oval has seldom been a profitable exercise. Not surprisingly, Australia stuck to the team that had won the previous test, while the England selectors, full of guilt, one hopes, brought back Hurst and Jessop for Tate, highly relieved to be back on duty with Sussex, and Ranji, while there was also a Surrey swap, with Tom Haywood taking Bobby Abel's place. Apart from a brisk and attractive 42 from Victor Trumper, the main Australian batsmen were in all sorts of trouble against Hurst. After starting life as a fast-medium left-arm bowler, who, from a lively run, gained pace off the pitch, he learned how to master the art of sharp and late in-swing, sometimes being able to straighten the ball on pitching. It was this late swing which enabled him to pick up the first five Australian wickets on the first day. Hurst was also a most capable and resolute performer with the bat, as he would show in both innings at the Oval. Added to this, he had just about the safest pair of hands in the business. In his career, he took 605 catches, mostly off hard drives when bowling or fielding at mid-off. Quite short and almost chubby, he was the most delightful of men with a lovely Yorkshire sense of humour. He was, too, a man who greatly encouraged the young, and after retiring spent 18 years as a hugely successful and popular coach at Eton. As a Test cricketer, he may not have been quite the equal of Rhodes, but there was not much in it. In 1906, he became the only man ever to score more than 2,000 runs and take over 200 wickets in the same season, a record that will never be equaled, let alone beaten. After Hurst had accounted for the top half of the Australian batting, the last three wickets, led by Hugh Trumbull, who made a painstaking 64 not out, put on 149. This irritated the 15-year-old Travers, who wrote that Trumbull's pottering about caused a good deal of lingering resentment and muffled snorting. In other words, he did rather well for Australia. Their final tally of 324 was made to seem a more than useful score by Trumbull, who bowled his off-breaks unchanged through both England innings and took 12 for 173 in the match. He bowled even better than he'd done at Old Trafford. And again, he...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.